So in the last class or the previous lesson, the one that we did was the digestive process. Today we'll be doing the respiratory process. Okay, so first of all, we have to know what are the stages of respiration. So basically, we can divide the respiration that we know, like external breathing, internal breathing, respiration, and all those things, into three. The first one being the gas exchange between external environment and the lungs. So that is the first one that we are focusing on. The second one, we will be focusing on the gas exchange that happens in alveoli. And finally, we'll be looking through cellular respiration as well. Right. First of all, when we speak about the gas exchange that takes place between the external environment and lungs, two main processes happen within. First thing is we intake oxygen into our lungs, and then we also have to remove the gaseous wastes that are accumulated during processes in the lungs. Okay, is it breaking? Okay, right. So, how is it? Is it clear now? The voice? Okay, right. So I think I was a bit away from the mic. So maybe that we can continue from here. Anyway, the gas exchange that happens between the external environment and lungs. So we are focusing on two things. One is where we intake oxygen when we breathe in, and when we breathe out, we try to remove as much of gaseous waste that are accumulated in cells. So can you tell me one of the waste materials that we breathe out? Yes, carbon dioxide is one such thing. So carbon dioxide is one of those wastes that we remove when we breathe out. So let us look at the structure and the organs that is available in our respiratory system. So we can see there are different parts or organs that are there in this system. But if you want to look at the most important one, so the basics one, we can see nasal cavity is one such thing. So this is where the air comes in first, and where it humidifies, and there are some changes that happens here as well. We will look into that as well. And inside the nasal cavity, in the opening of the nose, we have hairs, small follicular structures, hairs, which will filter out the dust particles and so on. And now we have an additional one which we cover the nose with, which is the mask due to this COVID-19. And after the nasal cavity, the air that we breathe in will pass to the pharynx. So it will pass into pharynx, and thereafter we will see that it will go into larynx. Larynx is actually the area where the sound box is. When we speak out, the sound that we hear due to the vibration of the vocal cords, those things are located in the larynx part, which is quite interesting to know of. And we can see a small diagram of that as well here. And then we have trachea. Trachea is the main or the long tube that will connect the parts of nasal cavity and pharynx to lungs. So this is where, this is like a passage where the air passes. Here also we have mucus and cilia, so that will trap the dust particles and so on. And then we have the bronchus. You can see the bronchus here as well. So bronchus is sort of like a branch or a node of a branch from trachea, and we have two parts of that for the right lung and the left lung as well. Then we have bronchioles, which are actually smaller parts of that or the subpart of that. And apart from that, we also have diaphragm, which is like an auxiliary organ or a structure in this case, which will help in breathing. We'll look into that, how it goes on. And we also have ribs, and then we have sternum, which is here, and we have some muscles that help us in this case as well. Sometimes we breathe using the buccal cavity as well. Can you tell me an instance where we use buccal cavity or the buccal cavity to breathe in and breathe out? When do we do that? Yeah, when we are very tired, actually, when we are very tired, when we go for practices or sports practices, let's say, and when we come back, and if you are extremely tired, we will try to use the buccal cavity as well to breathe in and breathe out for the processes. Now, one of those things that we have to know about the human respiratory system, especially the interior surface, is that it has a lot of mucus and cilia. So mucus has a similar structure to phlegm that we spit out when we have a sore throat or when we have some sort of cold, and small hair-like structures known as cilia. And these cilia are pointed upwards in the sense towards the nasal cavity. So we have small cilia in trachea and everything. These will help us to trap dust particles and small hair and whatever the small particles or external stuff that come into our lungs. So thereby it will be trapped in mucus, and the cilia will start to rhythmically push it out. So finally you will be able to spit it out or push it out. Do you have the experience where you go to a very dusty area and suddenly you feel the need to cough? Have you had that experience where you go to the ground or somewhere? Yeah. And what happens is you will cough out some dust. You don't know where it came from, but actually those minute particles went through your nasal cavity, and finally you have to cough out or breathe out or do whatever. But in that case, the cilia and mucus help us a lot. So we should understand, if the amount of mucus increases, that will also be a problem, because it will clog up our system and it will make us difficult to breathe. At the same time, if it reduces a lot, in that case also it will be a problem, because the interior of our lung is exposed. So that will also be a problem. So we'll look into that when we speak about the defects and diseases that can happen in the human respiratory system. Right. Shall we go for the next slide then? Right, okay. So let's go through what are the changes that take place when we inhale air. So when you take in air and when it comes through our nasal cavity, what are the changes that take place? One of the main thing is moisturizing and humidification of the inhaled air. So moisturizing in the case means it will be given a bit of a heavy weight. So if I put it in that way, you might be able to understand. The moisture, it becomes a bit of wet. There is a sort of wetness when we breathe in air. So sometimes when we are cold, what we do is we will take our hand, clasp our hand together and start rubbing. And if it does not work, we will start blowing air through the buccal cavity, through the mouth. Have you done that in your life before when it is very cold? Yes, we have done that. So what happens is it becomes warm, right? So we have that feeling. So when we breathe in air, it warms up the inhaled air so that it matches the body temperature. So you might be in a very cold area, suppose that you are going to Neuralia and or Haggala or Badulla or one of those areas, or Hapothalle, where it is very cold, or sometimes maybe in your area it might be very cold in the morning. So what happens is when it is very cold outside, but the air that we take in has to be balanced out. It should come down to the temperature of our body. So what happens is when we breathe in, when breathe in occurs, the air becomes, or it will normalize to the temperature of the body. So actually it's a good thing, and it's quite important for us as well. And finally, removal of foreign matter from inhaled air. So suppose we are breathing in a highly polluted environment and we are wearing mask and those things, it doesn't matter. But still, we know that with very small gaps that is between us, the air, whatever the dust particles that is there, can enter the nasal cavity. So there are some hairs and the mucus that will prevent from it entering actually into the lungs. And these are some of the changes that take place in the nasal cavity. Now, let us look into something else, which has to do with external breathing, to be honest. So the process of inspiration and expiration. I have given you both of them together, but rather in the book it is given as a separate process. So I think that we might be able to get the concept clearly in this case. So let's start with inspiration here. So why don't I take, this is better, right, okay. So we are starting with inspiration here. So when we breathe in air, So when we breathe in air, you can breathe in through your nasal cavity, through the nose, both of the nose, or you can, it will be nostrils, or it can be through the mouth. So when we breathe in air, what happens actually is it will pass through different organs of the body, especially let's say pharynx and larynx, and into the bronchus, trachea and those things. So what happens is the volume of the lungs will increase. We can see the volume of the lung will increase. So when the volume of lung increases, it actually means the thoracic cavity also should increase. Thoracic cavity is the cavity or the place where the lungs exist. So we have different cavities in the body. For example, we have the nasal cavity and all the buccal cavity that we just spoke of. And similarly, the location of lungs is the thoracic cavity. So if the volume of the lungs increases, obviously the thoracic cavity volume also has to increase. So to make it bigger, so when you inhale, actually the lungs capacity, thoracic capacity, all of them have to increase. To increase the volume, what happens is, one thing that happens is the intercostal muscles, the muscles that is in between the intercostal muscles, these things will start to contract. You can see that it is denoted by these red arrows. So it will start to contract. So when it contracts, the ribs will move upward. So the ribs will move upward. At the same time, what will happen is the sternum will move forward. I can donate it, actually I can denote it like this, to be honest. So the intercostal muscles will move up, and because of this, these ribs also will move up, and the sternum will move forward. So it is like that we are lifting something, right? And to make sure that we can accumulate as much of air as possible within the lungs, the diaphragm that is given here, you can see that it will contract. So we have a large capacity in this area, which is lungs. So it can take in oxygen as much as possible. So we call this process as inspiration, because we are taking in air. Now similarly, let's look at expiration. So expiration is actually the opposite of inspiration. So what do you think? The lung volume will increase or decrease in this case? Decrease. Very good. So the lung volume decreases. So actually what happens is the opposite of whatever that happened before. So the thoracic cavity will collapse, or it will reduce. And finally, these intercostal muscles, which had contracted earlier, will now start to relax. So when it relaxes, the ribs will come down, it will come to the original position, the sternum will return to the original position, and the diaphragm, which is actually a curved structure, muscular structure, it will start to relax. So it will automatically push all the air out of the lungs. So this is the process of inspiration and expiration. So are you okay with this stuff? Right, okay, let's go for the next one. Now we are going to speak about the second process that we spoke about, which is the exchange of gas that takes place in alveoli. So alveoli are small sac-like structures, very thin-walled sac-like structures that is inside lungs. So it is like a sponge. Our lung has a similar structure to a sponge that we use to wipe clean, stuff like that. And you know that sponge can hold a lot of water, and when you squeeze it, the water will be squeezed out of the sponge. Similarly, the lungs also have a very similar structure, and we have small sacs. These sacs we call, or they are known as alveoli, sacs, so plural, alveoli. So we can look at what happens, how this exchange occurs. Now I would like to ask you, when you want to do this exchange, do you have to spend energy or don't you have to spend energy? What do you think? Yes, you have told that we have to spend energy, but rather our body is designed in such a way that where we do not spend energy for this. So this is purely by the concentration difference that is available. So it happens via diffusion. So diffusion is where some particles move from a very highly concentrated area to a low concentrated area. You might have studied about diffusion and osmosis, right? Can you remember those stuff? Yes, okay. So via diffusion, so that means there is no active energy involved. So what happens is here, first of all, when we breathe in, we can see that when we breathe in, a large amount of oxygen will come and fill this area. So when a large amount of oxygen comes and fill this area, the concentration of oxygen inside the alveoli is great. It's very high. It is higher than whatever that is available in the outside capillary network. So capillary is actually, you might know this, these are small tubes that are very, very thin, and it is the part of the circulatory system, and we'll be studying about circulatory system later as well. So this is a one wall structure. So as the concentration of oxygen is very high inside and it is low outside, the oxygen will diffuse to the capillary. At the same time, what happens is when we want to breathe out, what happens is the amount of waste material that is available in this particular capillary network is very high, especially carbon dioxide. But the air that we breathe in has less amount of carbon dioxide. So what happens is, similar to the way that oxygen diffuses, this carbon dioxide will diffuse out and into the alveoli. So we can see that there are some blood cells inside the capillary and there are some other gaseous materials in the capillary, but only the gaseous waste will be diffused out, but blood cells cannot be diffused out. We have to remember that as well. And they have mentioned some features that we will go to that later as well. The thickness of alveoli is only one cell. That means it's a single cellular structure. That is what is given here for that, and it is actually quite a correct elaboration that we are given here. And the capillary network around the alveoli is very extensive. You can see that there are a lot of branches as well. So this is what happens and how the gas exchanges. So this surface that you can see, it is marked in blue color. This surface is known as respiratory surface. Respiratory surface is the wall of alveoli. So this is where the exchange of gases happens between the internal environment, which is the body, and external environment, which is the outside atmosphere. So that is the particular surface where the respiration occurs. So respiration occurs in the wall of alveoli. So if you asked a question regarding that, you should be able to answer that as well. Now, what are the characteristics that should be present in a respiratory surface? So we have to know that as well. There are four main characters. The first thing is, it should be moistened and it should be permeable for gases. Permeable means it's not semi-permeable, but it should be permeable for gas. That means gases should be able to pass. It should be moist. Moist in the case so that it will be high in humidity and it will permit in passage of gases. So what are the gases that transfer in and out? Can you just tell me what are the gases that will transfer in and out most of the time? Yes, oxygen and carbon dioxide. And second thing, it is thin. It should be thin. Why do you think it should be thin rather than thick? Yes, it is easier to diffuse in and out. Yeah, it can pass easily. So simple as that. The thinner it is, the easier it is to transfer in and out. The second thing is, it should have a large surface area. So why do you think it should have a large surface area? Yeah, we can put it in a different way. As you said, let's look at it in this way. Suppose that you are going to, let's say, to the post office, and you can see a large or a long queue in front of the post office. That is usually because that may be due to this restriction, but mostly because there is only one counter which might be open. But if we have several counters open inside the post office, just to do this stuff and like that, the amount of people standing in long queues will be reduced. That is because there are a lot of places where you can make contact with. Similarly, if we have a large surface area, a large volume of gas can come in and come out as well. And the next thing is, it should be highly vascularized. Vascularized in the sense, it means that it should have a good network of blood, yeah, and so that the blood can carry the stuff. You know that blood is the main way of transporting stuff in and out. So in that case, blood is quite important. So that vascularized, the system of vascularization should be there in a respiratory surface. Now let us see if we have those structure or those things in the alveoli. So first of all, let's see if these alveoli have the same stuff that we need. So first of all, let's see that the first thing is, the alveolar wall is thin. So is this good or is this bad? It's actually good, well done. So the wall of alveolar should be thin, because as it is, the thinner it is, the easier it is to diffuse. So actually it is one wall or one cell thickness, and it is also moist. So moist means it will be helpful for the passing of gas, passing of this gas in the sense, I mean permeability. So it will be permeable for gases, and there is a presence of blood network capillary around alveoli, so that the gaseous waste can go out and oxygen can come into the blood. And finally, there is a large number of alveolar sacs. So as there are a large number of alveolar sacs, there is a large amount of surface area. So as there is a large amount of surface area, it will facilitate in easy and efficient and huge quantity of gaseous exchange, right? Now we were looking at two processes. One is where we do the actual breathing, which is taking gases in and pushing gases out. And then we also discussed about the contact surface that is there, the respiratory contact surface, so that the gas can come in, the oxygen can come in and into our cells. Now the blood has brought these particular materials into the cells. So now we have to understand what is respiration in terms of cell. So what is cellular respiration? So this is almost the correct definition of respiration. Taking gases in and sending gases out is not respiration. It is actually breathing. So what is respiration? So respiration is actually one definition given here, but rather I have broken down so that it is easy for us to remember. It is the process of oxidation of simple foods. We oxidize simple foods. Why do we have to do that? To produce energy. So why do we need energy? We need energy for our activities, biological activities. For example, eating, then running, then jumping, playing, thinking, or whatever the mental or the process that we are doing. Do you think we need energy to sleep? I'll put it this way. So first of all, I'll make a comment and then I'll try to explain it out, because rather than making the comment, if you don't have energy, it means you are dead. It simply means that when we are sleeping, we actually breathe in and breathe out. The circulatory system works within the body. We turn left and right sometimes. So all these processes needs energy, right? Do you agree? Yes. So in that case, respiration occurs from your birth until death. So if you don't respirate, or there is no respiration in the body, it means that you are dead. That is why we say that these processes occur within living cells. So I hope that you got the definition correctly. The process of oxidation of simple foods, right? That means when you say oxidation of simple food, I'll ask you a very different sort of a question. When you say oxidation of simple food, what do you mean when you say oxidation? Do you think there is some sort of a gas involved here? What gas? What do you think? Yes, very good. Oxygen. That means using oxygen, you are doing something which is producing energy and you are using it for your biological activities, whatever the activities that occur within the body or using your body, and it happens within living cells, not dead cells. So we have an equation for respiration. This equation is very how do I put it? This equation may be very familiar to you. Now I'll ask you something that is not directly relevant to this particular topic. The first equation, which is given in green color, have you seen this before? Is it familiar to you? Where? In which subject did you discuss this? Yes, chemical basis of life, and you might have learned about this in photosynthesis, right? But what is the difference between photosynthesis and respiration? If you want, I can give you a clue as well. Yeah, the simply as you mean, photosynthesis is the reverse of this, right? So it will be CO2 plus H2O will give you glucose, oxygen, and then using energy only we do these things, right? Anyway, so respiration is actually, you can say it is almost the opposite of photosynthesis. And anyway, we'll look at this respiration now. Respiration is where we take in glucose molecules and we bind it with oxygen, and then we produce energy. So energy is the main output that we are focused on here. So this is the main output that we are focused on, not anything else. So carbon dioxide and water are byproducts. So how do we expel carbon dioxide from our body? How? Now, glucose and oxygen will bind together to form carbon dioxide, water and energy. Now this water can be exhaled or excreted through our excretory system. Energy is needed for us. Carbon dioxide is a waste product. So how can we remove carbon dioxide from our body? Yeah, simply by exhaling, by breathing out, we can remove this particular thing. Just remember, we call this as aerobic respiration because oxygen is involved. So as oxygen is involved, we call this as aerobic respiration, right? So what are the types of cellular respiration? As I mentioned before, there are two types. One is aerobic and the other one is anaerobic, or we can say anaerobic respiration. So what do we mean by aerobic respiration? The respiration that takes place when oxygen is available or in the presence of oxygen is known as aerobic respiration. But if there is some sort of respiration and it happens when there is no oxygen, we call this as anaerobic respiration. Now, how does this anaerobic respiration work? Let's look at that. The first thing we are going to look at it is in plants. In plants, we have a special term for anaerobic respiration. We call that as alcohol fermentation. The reason we call alcohol fermentation is, now we can see that this glucose that we have here, the glucose that is available here is broken down into carbon dioxide, ethyl alcohol and energy. Because of this alcohol, we call this as alcohol fermentation. In this case also, we have some energy. You can see that energy is released, but it is not as much as aerobic respiration. We can get a lot of energy from aerobic respiration, From anaerobic respiration, we get a low amount of energy. In animals, we call that as lactic acid fermentation. The reason is the glucose will be broken down into lactic acid and energy. Now, have you experienced sometimes when you do something, when you do exercises for a long time, or when you start running for a long time, and when you work continuously, you might get cramps in your legs and hands. Have you felt that before? Yes, that is because of this. That is because of lactic acid fermentation. This is one reason. The reason being that, suppose that you are working too hard and sometimes there is not enough oxygen in your body, what will happen is still energy is required to do your work. Let's say that you are running a marathon, you are running a race, and after some time your body runs out of oxygen and you do not breathe in and out properly. Because you are so much focused on winning, you do not breathe in or breathe out properly. What happens is, in that particular part of the body, due to lack of oxygen, anaerobic respiration will take place. This anaerobic respiration will make or form lactic acid. This lactic acid causes cramps within our legs and arms. Is it okay? Right, okay. Now, we were speaking about energy. What is this energy actually? This energy is stored as molecules. These molecules are known as ATP molecules. Adenosine triphosphate molecules. We call this as ATP molecules. So, what are the functions of ATP molecules? So, why do we need that? We mainly need it for three purposes. These molecules are important to store the energy that is produced from respiration. And secondly, we need it to release the energy as well. So it is like a capsule where it stores and releases as well, and it also acts as an energy carrier. We can that this molecules can carry the energy that is stored there to different places. It is like let's say that a rechargeable battery. So if you take a rechargeable battery, can you store energy in it or can't you? Yeah, what sort of energy can you store in a rechargeable battery? Let's put it in this way. We can store electrical energy in that because it's a battery. And this electrical energy can be released when we discharge it. Suppose we are connecting into a mobile phone or something, we can release it. And also we can carry it around. Suppose we want to give it to another person, we can carry it around. So similarly, this ATP works in our body as well. So, I hope you got the concept regarding respiration, right? Right. Now, let us look at some of the diseases which are associated with the respiratory system. So, I have given you a list of diseases. We'll go through this a bit in detail very soon. The first one being common cold, and then we have pneumonia, asthma, bronchitis, TB or tuberculosis, silicosis and asbestosis. Now, I have made it into a chart so that it will be easy for us to understand these concepts easily. Now, we have common cold. So, common cold is caused by a virus. So, usually the viral infection will turn into a common cold. So, the main symptoms are sneezing, running nose, cough and headache. So, these are the main symptoms that is associated with common cold. And one of the interesting facts that I have given to you on the next thing is, it does not have any medical treatment. You can't cure common cold. You might be shocked. Why can't we cure common cold? Because it is curable. No, we do not have any medical treatment to cure common cold, but we can cure the symptoms. We can cure the cough or the running nose, sneezing, headache. So when you go to the doctor and you say, "Doctor, I have a running nose problem or I have a cough," he will treat you or give you a medicine so that these symptoms can be treated. But we should remember that common cold is not something which we can treat because it is caused by a virus. we can see that this COVID-19 that we have now, there is no cure for COVID-19. But there are some immunity-based injections that are given to us as doses. This may help in preventing this COVID-19 from infecting us. So, similarly, there is no medical treatment for common cold. So, have you heard about pneumonia disease? Yes, this is a very dangerous disease that has infected the human world, to be honest. It can be caused by virus or it can be caused by a bacteria. So, what happens is you might have non-stop, prolonged cold and or cough. You can have cold and cough, or you might have cough only or cold only. So, what happens is in our lungs, some fluid will accumulate. Fluid in the sense this mucus will dissolve and it can accumulate as well. So, whenever we start to, cough, it will be very difficult for us and there will be a lot of phlegm and we might find it difficult to breathe as well sometimes. So, this asthma that we speak about, this can be caused by different sort of minute particle, very small particle. For example, dust, they are very small particles. Then we have pollen, fur. For example, some people are allergic to cat fur and there can be allergy to smoke. And you might see that some of the teachers, they are allergic to chalk. Chalk in the sense what we write on the board, they will cover their faces because they can get asthma from that as well. The main problem that we might get is difficulty in breathing. And you might have a burning sensation within the lungs. So, we call that as inflammation of lungs. The burning feeling. Your lungs will start to burn from inside out. So, we call this inflammation of lung. So, that is also a very dangerous disease, to be honest. And then we have bronchitis. Bronchitis happens when your lungs swell. For example, you might know what swelling is, right? Yes. Just to make it much more clearer, if you take something and soak it in water, let's say something like a piece of bread and you soak it in water, it will start to swell. That means it will start to absorb a lot of fluid that is available here, water, and it will become bigger in size. So similarly, bronchitis happens when our lungs swell. So because of that, it will be very difficult for us to breathe. And there can be some heavy cough as well. This is due to the virus or the bacteria that is available or that has caused it. Now, one of those diseases that has still been troubling us a long time is this one, which is known as TB or tuberculosis. It is actually caused by a bacteria, and you might know the name of the bacteria from your grade 9 syllabus as well. So, there can be a lot of symptoms. You might feel tired. You don't want to eat, you don't like to eat, suddenly you might lose your weight, and when you cough, you might get blood and pieces of tissue as well, and you might have high amount of fever. This is because the lungs start to break down slowly. So when the lungs break down, whatever the pieces of lungs, these tissues that is available, alveolar section, everything, when you breathe out, when you cough out, these things also will come out. And blood will start to leak into the lungs, and because of this, when we spit out, we might get blood in our spit as well. So these are the main diseases that infect the Sri Lankans with regard to the respiratory system. If you are working in a factory that produces glassware, you might be exposed to silicon dust. We know that glass is made from silicon, right? Yes. So, because of this dust, we might get silicosis. This is also a type of disease because of this dust, similar to asthma. And asbestos can cause asbestosis. So, these are some of the diseases that are associated with our respiratory system. And finally, we have to speak about smoking. So, when we speak about smoking, the diseases associated with smoking There are several parts of smoking. So let's go to that step by step. One is carbon monoxide. That means carbon binds with one oxygen, not two. So these carbon monoxide, what they can do is they can bind with hemoglobin in our blood. We know that hemoglobin is important, or it is the carrier of oxygen within the blood. So if more amount of carbon monoxide bind with hemoglobin, there will be less amount of hemoglobin available for oxygen. So we won't get enough oxygen in our lungs, or it won't be able to pass out. And the second thing is this nicotine. Nicotine is like a boost. It will suddenly increase our heart rate, but not permanently, but temporarily. And then we have the destruction of cilia. Because of these particles and everything, these small hair-like particles will be destructed, and it will cause inflammation in our bronchioles and trachea. And this cigarette smoke, we know that it has a lot of harmful chemicals. Some of the chemicals can induce growth of cancer cells. So finally, ultimately, what will happen is the person who smokes can face death, which is not quite good as well. So that is the end of today's lesson. Do you have any questions regarding this lesson?